confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Amen.
I said I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord.
And you forgave me the iniquity of my sins.
O Almighty God, merciful Father,
I, a poor miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserved your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them. And I pray you of your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, my poor sinful being.
Upon this your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto all of you. And in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. And we continue with the hymn 806, Give Thanks with a Grateful Heart, as printed in your service.
Thank you.
your goodness, still you provide for all our needs of body and soul. Grant us your Holy Spirit that we may acknowledge your gifts, give thanks for all your benefits, and serve you in willing obedience. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The congregation may be seated at this time, and for our elders, we're going to be going from lectern to pulpit, so we'll want to mute and unmute. And our students' confirmation verses are wrapped within each reading that they read to you, and then they will follow that up with a God moment paper, which at their young lives shares with each of you, with all of us, where they've already seen God working in their lives. So our first reading today is from Lila.
She check my eyes over, but said that it was normal for them to do that at my age. My parents were not convinced, so they noticed they were not getting better. They decided it was time to seek to an eye specialist in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. The specialist examined my eyes and decided I needed surgery for both my eyes. He said that if I don't have surgery, my brain would shut down one of my eyes, and I would be pretty much blind in that eye. In the meantime, he wanted my parents to patch each of my eyes for an hour every day and try to strengthen the muscles. This ended badly, as I needed it. I had the first surgery around 2 years old. My mom and dad have told me that they were so worried about me going into the surgery, but God brought them peace and support. Their pastor left me and showed up in the waiting room to pray with them during my surgery. They have made sure to tell me how grateful they were to have him show up at just the right time for those much needed prayers. God has always been there for me, for all of us, and many times he uses others to help us. My parents have always made sure to tell me that God doesn't make mistakes. Everyone is here for a reason, and he has a plan for it. We have to go through trials sometimes to help us humble and realize that our flaws are our gifts and are given to help others. I had another surgery when I was 4 years old and always had to wear very thick, heavy glasses. My mom pointed out that I have never let my eyes get me down. She said I am stronger because of this, and God has a plan for me. In third grade, I started having trouble with my school. I remember my mom getting mad at me because she thought I just didn't want to do my homework. But it was really because I couldn't see the words and the numbers properly, or I would see double. This caused me to get headaches and cry a lot. Then God sent a helper through Mrs. Ackerman. She explained to my mom that she really thought my eyes were causing issues. My mom took me to another surgeon specialist in the cities and told her I was just going through a phase and not wanting to do my homework, and that it wasn't my eyes. Mrs. Ackerman was not convinced, though, as it was not for the first time she had seen this. She convinced my parents they could talk to some of her parents, the parents of students, about how eye therapy could help me, and it worked. Again, God sent helpers of a special eye doctor that found
he wasn't used to losing, and I wasn't used to seeing an image. I believe God has a reason for everything. God was teaching us that we had to adjust to different ways of coaching, playing and more about the game. And after school season was over, we got our old coach back, and we went on that shift and we still started. The season this year is off to a horrible start. We didn't get to play in school ball season. The team and I were very excited for this season, as we were going to have a new school ball coach. This coach would have helped us to get things to learn even more about the sport I was doing, and have been so blessed to be so great at. God has helped us through this finally, because we were able to get back all kinds of good. Though I was bummed that I didn't get up playing full season of baseball, God presented me with more family time and new games ready to play ball. Golfing has become a fun new thing that I've got to try out with my family and friends. Due to the challenging times in the past few months, God has brought me new opportunities to my whole family. If this baseball season would have happened as usual, we would have been too busy to do any other projects, or we would have even had time to talk. Right now, the plans I have for you, first of all, are plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope in the future. Jeremiah 29:11.
Our Holy Gospel today comes to us from St. Matthew, the 19th chapter. Then children were brought to him that he might lay his hands on them and pray. The disciples rebuked the people, but Jesus said, "Let the little children come to me and do not hinder them, for to such belongs the kingdom of heaven." And he laid his hands on them and went away. This is the Gospel of the Lord. And we now confess our common faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We continue as we open our hymnal to our hymn of the day, 707. Oh, that the Lord would guide my ways. And mistakes is one thing that I make quite often. So that was a great gospel reading, but I got something greater. Sarah Mazowski is going to share with us her reading as well as her God moment.
The fourth reading is from Romans 8, verse 31-39.
What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own Son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? From simple things like waking me up each day to caring for and loving the people I love, to using earthly things like movies to work in my heart for His good, He blesses me and loves me each and every day the same. I am certain that nothing, not anything of this world or not of this world, can separate me from His love. Praise God for His loving moments that shine in my life every day, now, in the past, and in the future.
That God is working to His good and glorious will. But that's not what we heard in the text today, two readings earlier, in the Gospel of Matthew 19. Because the disciples rebuked the children for wanting to come forward to our Lord. Rebuked them, wanting to stop them. Now, mind you, Jesus had been traveling in the land of Galilee. He was tired. The disciples were tired. But the children wanted to come to the Lord. And the disciples unknowingly got in the way. They wanted to prevent the children from coming forward. But you know, Jesus hadn't finished what he came to do for you and I. He hadn't gone to the cross yet for you and I. As Sarah mentioned, it's very difficult for us to watch and even imagine what our Lord and Savior went through on the cross for us. But he wasn't there yet. And so it was not his time to rest. It was not yet finished. And he calls the children forward after he rebukes the disciples. But interestingly, after this in the text, the disciples seem to put more value in the wealthy man than they do in the children. You see, that's our sin-filled nature. In our society today, we look to those that have and what people can do for us instead of looking to our children. And all of you are children of God. You are redeemed in the blood of Christ. In ancient times, these children, they had the lowliest of status. But our Lord and Savior put them first. He elevated them and brought them forward. Jesus, in our reading from Matthew 19, teaches us the value of children. They have an untainted heart. Could you not hear it in their God-moment papers? The reign of heaven does not prioritize over one person or another. Even the lowliest of us are welcome. And Jesus invites his disciples to believe heaven is for the people who are like the children. Lowly, poor, destitute, hurting. You and I, that's who heaven's for. We listened to what our children had to say. Lila was so great to share with us the power of God and the power of prayer and to know that you in this community were praying for her and her family. What a blessing it is to know the power of God and to hear it come out of the mouth of a babe. And out of our eyes, right? And if you didn't cry with me, you should have. So thank you for sharing. And then we heard, we're going to have to get to you last. Sorry, Sarah. We heard from Brooke. And we heard, again, a story. You know, and I'm reminded of Saul when his scales fell off his eyes and he was able to see. But what I heard in this story is how people, and in Lila's story in her life too, how God continues to put people in our lives. How he continues to send people to be there for us at the right times. And so yes, when we may feel that we're drowning and we're out of control, we're depressed, we're lonely, we're hurting, just know, remember what these students shared with you today. That God is always working. And he's working through the people around you. Lift up your heads and see the blessing that God has bestowed before you. Brennan, a man after my own heart, said that I played football. Loves baseball. His grandpa told me yesterday he could play 365 days a year. He would. But here's the blessing. God has granted each of us, including Brennan, strengths and abilities, different vocations, gifts. We have some who are gifted in the musics, in the arts, some in sports, some who love to read. We all have different gifts. And that's what we heard from Brennan today, is that God works for our glorious gifts. And there are times where he opens up doors for us when it otherwise looked like it had been closed earlier this year. God is good and gracious. And then I talked, and then Sarah came in, and she really could have finished off the service today, because that was a beautiful sermon. To share the love of Christ, to know that you may not have had many difficult challenges in your life. God's still there. You may not necessarily see all the blessings in your life, but they're there every day, as Sarah shared with us. See, God does little things in our lives, and it's those little things, working through people like you, serving these students, because each of you have been a big part. Each of you, God has been working through as you continue to raise up these students, that they may know the love of Christ Jesus, he who was crucified for you, as Sarah shared with us. How wonderful that we have a loving God. How wonderful that each of you are counted as his children. Each of you are guaranteed eternal life and salvation because God loves you, because he sent his one and only Son for you, and he shed his blood for you. So as we confessed earlier this morning, and as I gave that absolution to you, whether you receive Holy Communion or not today, you are forgiven. You are redeemed by Jesus Christ. And yes, one day soon, God will welcome you, his children, home and say, welcome. And well done, my good and faithful servants. Well done. In Jesus' name, amen. Now may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. And for our visitors and guests, we will be receiving Holy Communion today. And we're going to try to limit it to about 15 people, and we want the immediate families with their students. And so all are welcome to come forward. And if you're a member of the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod, we welcome you to receive communion with us today. If you're from another denomination, we welcome you to come forward for a blessing. Just place your arms across your chest like this for a blessing, and the elders will know to pass by as I come by and bless you. And we also have been doing an Immanuel, is putting our offering in the plate as we exit the sanctuary on our way out to minimize passing by people and passing plates down the pews. And so now at this time, we begin with the rite of confirmation, which I realize we normally would have sponsors and maybe the parents come forward. We're just going to have the students come forward and kneel at the rail. Beloved in the Lord, our Lord Jesus Christ said to his apostles, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. You have been baptized and catechized in the Christian faith, according to our Lord's bidding. Jesus said, whoever confesses me before men, I will also confess before my Father who is in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, I will also deny before my Father who is in heaven. Lift up your hearts, therefore, to the God of all grace, and joyfully give answer to what I now ask you in the name of our Lord. And the students are following along on page 272 if you wish to join them. Do you this day in the presence of God and of this congregation acknowledge the gifts that God gave you in your baptism? Do you renounce the devil? Do you renounce all his works? Do you renounce all his ways? Do you believe in God the Father Almighty?
Yes, I believe in God the Father Almighty.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord? Do you believe in the Holy Spirit?
Yes, I believe.
Do you hold all the prophetic and apostolic scriptures to be the inspired word of God? Do you confess the doctrine of the Evangelical Lutheran Church, drawn from the scriptures as you have learned to know it from the small catechism, to be faithful and true? Do you intend to hear the word of God and receive the Lord's Supper faithfully? Do you intend to live according to the word of God and in faith, word, and deed to remain true to God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, even to death? Do you intend to continue steadfast in this confession and church and to suffer all, even death, rather than fall away from it? We rejoice with thankful hearts that you have been baptized and have received the teaching of the Lord. You have confessed the faith and been absolved of your sins. As you continue to hear the Lord's word and receive His blessed sacrament, He who has begun a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. Amen. Please kneel. And Lila Marie Hubbard's confirmation verse, Proverbs 31:25. Strength and dignity are her clothing, and she laughs at the time to come. Lila Marie Hubbard. The Almighty God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given you new birth of water and of the Spirit, and has forgiven you all your sins, strengthen you with His grace to life everlasting. Amen. Brooke Marie Rosso, your confirmation verse is Isaiah 43:2. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. Brooke Marie Rosso, the Almighty God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given you the new birth of water and of the Spirit, and has forgiven you all your sins, strengthen you with His grace to life everlasting. Amen. Brendan Randall Rumpy, your confirmation verse is Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans for welfare and not for evil, to give you a future and a hope. Brendan Randall Rumpy, the Almighty God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given you the new birth of water and of the Spirit, and has forgiven you all your sins, strengthen you with His grace to life everlasting. Amen. Sarah Elizabeth Mazowski, your confirmation verse is Romans 8:38-39. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation, will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Sarah Elizabeth Mazowski, the Almighty God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given you the new birth of water and of the Spirit, and has forgiven you all your sins, strengthen you with His grace to life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty and most merciful Father, in the waters of holy baptism, you have united your children in the suffering and death of your Son, Jesus Christ, cleansing them by his blood, renewing them the gift of your Holy Spirit, that they may live in daily contrition and repentance with a faith that ever clings to their Savior. Deliver them from the power of Satan and preserve them from false and dangerous doctrines, that they may remain faithful in hearing Christ's word and receiving his body and blood. By the Lord's Supper, strengthen them to believe that no one can make satisfaction for sin but Christ alone. Enable them to find joy and comfort only in him, learning from this sacrament to love you and their neighbor and to bear their cross with patience and joy until the day of the resurrection of their bodies to life immortal. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Peace be with you. Please return to your seats. And we continue with our service and the prayers of the church. And today, again, we give God thanks and praise for our four confirmants, that he has brought them, starting at the waters of baptism, to where they are today and about to receive his true body and true blood. And we also give God thanks and praise for each of you for continuing to be there and to raise them up in the faith. So let us go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, you have bidden to us to come without money to receive grace beyond price. Hear us as we heed your call and turn to you in prayer, confident of your promise to hear and answer us. Father, we have sought meaning, comfort, and sustenance from all the wrong places. Grant us your Holy Spirit that our hearts may be turned to your word, that we may hunger for your Son's body and blood, and that we may discern truth from error. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we give you thanks that you have blessed us beyond what we deserve and given to us your church. Guard her life by your Spirit and strengthen her witness before the nations. Bless all pastors and church workers in their service to us in your name, and bless those now considering and preparing for church work vocations. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we thank and praise you for your great goodness in bringing Lila, Brooke, Brennan, and Sarah to the knowledge of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and enabling them both with the heart to believe and with the mouths to confess his saving name. Grant that, bringing them forth the fruits of faith, they may continue steadfast and victorious to the day when all who have fought the good fight of faith shall receive the crown of righteousness. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we suffer with all manner of ills and afflictions. Hear us and grant to us healing according to your will, strength in time of trial and peace at the last. We pray especially for those who are on our hearts at this time. Good Lord, deliver us and teach us to depend upon your grace in all things. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Father, we know that your steadfast love and mercy are forever, but our faith is daily tested and tempted. Give us strength and endurance that we may not despair, but have confidence in your sufficient grace. Guide us to seek our consolation in your word and sacraments, and prepare us to receive the Lord's body and blood in this holy communion. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we ask you to grant us all things needful and to keep from us all things harmful to us and to our salvation. For we trust your wisdom and your love. Teach us to pray without fear, your will be done. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we now continue with the service of the sacrament. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is meet and right, so true.
It is truly meet, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, who with your only begotten Son and the Holy Spirit are one God, one Lord. In the confession of the only true God, we worship the Trinity in person and unity in substance of majesty co-equal. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, if Sarah and her immediate family, and we can take up to about 15, would like to come forward with Sarah as she receives her first communion. And Sarah, we'll put you right at the center.
Thank you.
We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy, you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bless we the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
Please be seated as we sing our closing hymn, hymn 922, Go My Children with My Blessing. So the way we normally do this is we exit from the rear out. So Brennan, we will let your family depart first, and then we'll go to the rock. the Hubbards, then the Matuszewskis. So go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Either that or I thought you skipped on.